After taking a COVID test, you get the results. You've tested positive. You're infected with a large amount of the virus and contagious. Your recent contacts need to quarantine, and you might need to be admitted to hospital. Right? Wrong. Well, maybe. Let me tell you why. I'll start with a story of three men who wanted to fly from Singapore to Bangkok. These men had already been sick with COVID and recovered. Their return to Thailand was contingent on testing negative for the virus in Singapore. So in Singapore, they were tested and their negative results were certified by the Thai embassy. However, when they landed in Bangkok and entered quarantine and were tested again, the results were positive. This brought all kinds of speculation in the media that these men had been reinfected. Come along with me as we break down this case and understand how it underscores the need for us to change how we talk about COVID testing. I'll show you how COVID testing really works and what needs to change. Globally, we have completed more than 400 million COVID-19 tests and counting. Laboratory testing has played an important role in diagnosing the disease as well as identifying individuals who are asymptomatic yet have the potential to transmit the virus. In fact, testing has become an integral part of a three-pronged strategy to reduce transmission of the virus: case identification, contact tracing, and quarantine and isolation of exposed and infected individuals. Yet, despite the broad application of this strategy, the global number of cases continues to accelerate. So are we doing something wrong? And what can we do to improve our battle against the virus? To understand what we're doing wrong, we have to first understand how COVID testing works. Molecular tests have been the most common diagnostic tool to detect cases of COVID-19. Specifically, we're going to talk about testing using reverse transcriptase quantitative polymerase chain reaction, or just PCR testing for short. The first step is to take a swab of your nasal or throat area. That sample is sent to a laboratory where they will use the PCR technique. And they use PCR to look for specific sequences of genetic matter that are characteristic of the COVID virus. Since the bits of viral genetic matter might be tiny, PCR amplifies that genetic matter in a series of cycles. It amplifies those genetic bits over and over until there's enough to be detected. If a sample has lots of virus in it, it should only take a few cycles to amplify the viral bits enough to be detected. But if a sample only has trace amounts of the virus, it will take many more cycles to amplify that small bit of virus such that it can be detected. The number of cycles it takes until a detectable amount of virus has been replicated is called a cycle threshold, or CT. And that brings us to how we're interpreting test results wrong. Think of those two samples, one full of virus, the other with only trace amounts. In either case, the results will be returned as positive. But if you remember, the power in testing is not just knowing you're sick, but in identifying people who are infectious before they can infect others. Generally, the approach has been that if someone tests positive, then we interpret that they are actively infected and are infectious. The problem is both of these interpretations are not necessarily correct. First, testing positive doesn't mean you're still infectious. To be infectious, which means being able to make someone else sick, requires two things. First, it requires that you are shedding virus. Shedding virus means that virus is found in your droplets created when you sneeze, cough, or breathe. PCR testing absolutely tells us whether you are shedding virus. The second thing infectiousness requires, though, is that the virus you're shedding is viable. In other words, that the virus can survive and grow. PCR doesn't do this. To do that, we have to isolate the virus sample in the lab, culture it, and see whether it replicates. So PCR doesn't actually measure infectiousness. But remember earlier, I talked about that cycle threshold? Well, studies have shown that there is a relationship between cycle threshold and infectiousness. So the CT can act as a good indicator of whether or not somebody is infectious. This study, published on August 13th by researchers at Public Health England, shows us exactly how infectiousness is related to the PCR cycle threshold. What we see is that at low CT values of 15 to 20, meaning lots of virus in the sample, nearly 100% of the virus that was shed was infectious. However, as the CT value increased to 35 cycles or higher, where only trace amounts of virus were sampled, virtually none of that virus could be cultured. So those individuals were not infectious. The problem, though, is that results are generally reported back to the physician as positive or negative. It gives a simple yes-no answer to the question of whether a patient is infected. The results generally don't report the cycle threshold and therefore don't provide a measure of the viral load in the sample. Many laboratory protocols will allow up to 40 cycles or more before they cut it off and declare the test negative. The problem is that someone with a CT value of 20 and a person with a CT value of 35 are completely different in terms of infectivity. There is another way we are interpreting test results incorrectly. Testing positive doesn't mean you're even sick at all. PCR testing is so good at detecting viral bits that it can even detect fragments of viral matter that our body may shed well after we've already recovered. We know this because we have documented several case studies in which virus was shed for weeks and even months after recovery. This case report from Italy shows a man who shed virus and tested positive for 63 days. One patient in China shed the virus for 3 months. In a larger study that looked at 605 individuals that tested positive in Italy, they found that positivity in swabs lasted from 14 to 63 days with a median of 30 days. Scientists believe there are two explanations for this long shedding time. First, the virus seems to coexist in some patients well. In other words, it has found a way to evade the immune system for prolonged periods in some individuals. They're known as long haulers. While sick, they are not likely infectious beyond the first 7 to 10 days. The other reason is that after the immune system has successfully neutralized the virus, we still shed unviable virus fragments, and these can be detected by PCR. Going back to the men traveling from Singapore to Bangkok, they tested positive, but what was their CT value? And when they were tested in Singapore, at what point did they cut off the cycles before categorizing as negative? Without this information, it's hard to know whether it's really a reinfection, as described in the media, a reactivation of the same virus, or just an artifact of the PCR test. Now, reinfection is a real thing. It's been discovered in Hong Kong, along with the Netherlands, and recently in the US and India. But in many cases, a seemingly re-emergent case of COVID is actually just long-term shedding of viral fragments picked up by PCR tests. And that brings us to the bigger point. Using PCR inefficiently is hurting our fight against the coronavirus. Our decision to discharge someone from the hospital or release them from isolation relies heavily on negative PCR test results. Usually, you need to test negative in 2 consecutive tests. However, as we pointed out, a positive PCR result may not necessarily mean the person is still infectious or that he or she still has any meaningful disease, a point argued by 2 Harvard doctors in an editorial letter to Clinical Infectious Disease all the way back in May. As long as someone is considered positive for COVID-19, we need to direct resources towards that individual. They may require long-term hospitalization because the positive results mean they don't meet the requirements for discharge, or contact tracers may be working to track down results without considering whether or not that person was even transmitting the disease. Or a person might be held in isolation, which takes up space that could be used by someone else. In all these cases, resources are being used inefficiently. In a report by the New York Times, they looked at testing data that included CT values from several states. In Washington, about half of results would no longer qualify as positive if the CT value was cut off at just 35. And in Massachusetts, up to 90% of positive samples barely carried any virus. Basically, none of these cases actually require isolation and contact tracing, meaning we are wasting our limited resources when we don't direct them towards the cases that need them most. All of this together hurts our fight against COVID-19. In places like Thailand, New Zealand, or Vietnam, where cases are counted in the tens, this may not be a big deal, and perhaps it's better to be safe than sorry. It just causes unnecessary scares. In many other parts of the world, though, where daily cases are counted in the tens of thousands and prevalence is as high as 20% or more, inefficiently directing resources even to a small fraction of cases adds up very quickly, never letting us get ahead of the disease. So what do we do? Experts say that we need to change 3 things about COVID PCR testing. The first thing is that CT values should be returned with test results more often, rather than simply a positive or negative. At a minimum, they should be made available upon request. CT values tell us a lot about the probability of diagnosis and the likelihood of infectivity. The second thing experts are saying needs to change is how we run the tests themselves. Rather than using extremely high CT cutoff points, experts recommend using a lower CT value to register someone as testing positive for the virus. Various cutoff points have been proposed, generally around 30 to 35 cycles. The third thing that's being called for by some is to rely less on PCR tests altogether, Because the tests are labor-intensive and require specialized equipment, many hard-hit places like the U.S. are waiting days, even weeks, to hear results. Waiting this long is meaningless from a disease control or even clinical diagnosis standpoint. The alternative would be what's called point-of-care tests, which can be collected, analyzed, and reported within hours, and everything is completed on-site, for example, at your local doctor's office. While not as accurate as PCR, the quick results would more than make up for what you're losing in accuracy. As the director of clinical microbiology at UCLA Health System said, even if you miss somebody on day one, if you test them repeatedly, the argument is you'll catch them next time around. Our battle against the virus is constantly evolving, and the only way to gain the upper hand is to adapt and evolve based on experience. PCR testing is powerful, but should also be used in the appropriate circumstances. As our understanding of the complex immunological response to this novel virus improves, the way we detect and respond to the disease will also likely change. Hopefully, with these changes, we can globally suppress the disease. Thanks for watching. Please let me know what you think in the comments. Subscribe for future videos, and as always, thanks for watching.